Hello friends, welcome to another episode by Engineering Today. We're back with some latest space updates for you. Today we'll start with SpaceX's Starship Launch Tower integration in Florida, then we'll discuss the record-breaking booster return to Port Canaveral. We'll wrap up with NASA's upcoming Trailblazer launch. Let's begin with SpaceX starting their Starship Launch Tower integration process in Florida. We all know that SpaceX is presently working for their second Starship base, which is just a few hundred feet away from existing Falcon launch facilities in NASA's Kennedy Space Center pad LC-39A. And their progression in Florida is quickening its pace with time. Recently, they've begun stacking Starship's first Florida launch tower. And according to some reports, with completion of that Starship launch tower, it'll become the second tallest rocket-related structure on the East Coast, after NASA's massive vehicle assembly building. Keeping SpaceX's Starship Tower building experience of Boca Chica in view, it's plausible that SpaceX teams could easily complete the Florida launch tower to full height within a couple of months. This launch tower integration procedure has come up less than 6 months after SpaceX has resumed their work on Starship launch pad in Florida. Pad LC-39A is one of the busiest launch facilities in the U.S. According to sources, LC-39A is on track to support 10 Falcon 9 launches in the first half of 2022. This busy launch schedule will also put multiple restrictions on the developing Starship pad. So, construction of Starship's Pad 39A facilities near the busiest launch site is one of the exceptional challenges in front of SpaceX. But we can hope that they'll easily cope up with this challenge. Moreover, their orbital launch site construction experience in Texas will help them to develop the Florida site in a much more advanced and upgraded way, limiting the challenges as well as reducing impact on nearby other launch facilities. SpaceX teams have followed a policy of improving the assembly process of a number of pad components to reduce the time of work on pad itself. Earlier, during Starbase launch tower construction, it took nearly 3 months of afterwork for the engineers on the first prefabricated section to start stacking of the other sections. At that time, the post-stack was much more complicated and time-consuming than the pre-stack work. But now, for the Starship launch tower in Florida, SpaceX has increased the pre-stack time. As per reports, they devoted more than 3 months to assembling and precisely installing the first 6 of 9 prefabricated tower sections before they go for the first stack. And recently, on the 21st of June, SpaceX began stacking procedures. Other than prefabricated structural sections, they also have a range of walkways, elevator shafts, railings, doorways, hardpoints, and plumbing pre-installed on those structural sections. Though the plumbing and hardware of each section need to be connected after each stacking, yet this process will significantly reduce the post-stack work. Sources state that outside the Starship launch pad, SpaceX teams are assembling the orbital launch mount as well as working on the parts of the two giant robotic arms as well as the quick disconnect arm. While SpaceX is working on those three arms, SpaceX will also need to carry out work on giving connections of ground supplies of propellant located at Pad 39A to the developing launch tower. Earlier, Pad 39A never needed methane to fuel rockets, thus there's no provision of methane supplies. As Starship's main propellant is methane, so SpaceX will also require to install and activate a new tank farm and plumbing system in Florida Pad that will be capable of storing, rapidly subcooling, and supplying at least a few thousand tons of liquid methane to the rocket. Though Starbase of Florida is making great progress, but still a large amount of work needs to be done to attain launch readiness. In the following update, SpaceX's record-breaking B1060 Falcon 9 booster returns to port. Just a few days ago, SpaceX's B1060 Falcon 9 booster nailed the 13th launch and landing, creating a record. Recently, that record-breaking booster has returned to port on the 21st of June. Richard Engel, a photographer, wrote, "The fleet leader, B1060, returns to Port Canaveral following its 13th launch and landing. Great afternoon for a flight over the Atlantic to welcome back a Falcon 9 SpaceX." Falcon 9 booster B1060 was soon followed by the return of another booster, B1061. After completing the Global Star FM-15 mission, B1061 returned to Port Canaveral on the 22nd of June. This really proves that SpaceX has achieved a good launch cadence and will become a regular if SpaceX continues to launch an average of once per week. Till now, SpaceX has no signs of reducing their pace. B1060 has a good number of achievements under its name. Not only it nailed 13th launch and landing, but also, according to sources, it has altogether supported the launch of more than 640 satellites with a collective weight of around 165 tons. In terms of Starlink satellite launch, it alone launched almost 550 Starlink satellites, equating to a weight of more than 150 metric tons. Two other boosters, B1051 and B1058, are now close in record to B1060, with 12 launches completed by each. In mid-2020, Falcon 9 B1060 had carried out its first launch while delivering the U.S. military's third next-generation GPS-3 satellite. Last year, the booster broke SpaceX's own Falcon 9 turnaround record. At that time, B1060 was ready for its fifth launch almost 27 days after the fourth launch. Then, other than breaking SpaceX's own internal record, it also broke the 54 days turnaround record of NASA's space shuttle by a half. Some sources from SpaceX's senior engineers and executives state that SpaceX will no longer plan to use the Falcon boosters after the 15th flight. This is a significant indication that SpaceX will eventually shift wholly to the Starship launches for the massive commercial launch market. After the completion of the 15th launch by any Falcon boosters, SpaceX will take it out of regular commercial service, and then their engineers will carry out detailed inspections of that booster. And according to the results, they'll decide whether to certify all present and future Falcon boosters for 15 launches each. Till now, it's not clear whether SpaceX will strictly follow the 15 launch limit. It's possible that they may continue to use the most flown productive boosters like B1060, B1051, and B1058 for further reuse in their future Starlink missions, provided that they meet all safety requirements. And we can say that we may not need to wait for a long time to see SpaceX's decision. According to the present launch cadence of SpaceX, there's a high possibility that B1060, B1051, and B1058 could easily complete 15 launches before the end of 2022. Report says that booster B1049 will be expended after its 11th launch later this year. According to some reports, if SpaceX's plan is to totally remove boosters from service after 15th flight, then SpaceX's Falcon 9 fleet will shrink to 12 to 8 boosters by early 2023. We'll wrap up with NASA's upcoming launch of Lunar Trailblazer. On the 21st of June, Lori Glaze, NASA's Planetary Science Division Director, stated during a presentation to the Planetary Science Advisory Committee that, "We have removed Lunar Trailblazer from the IMAP manifest so that it can fly sooner." She also said that the Lunar Trailblazer mission will now launch as a secondary payload on the second lunar lander mission by Intuitive Machines, called IM-2, which is a part of NASA's Commercial Lunar Payload Services program. Glaze further said that the mission will launch within a year. This recent change in rideshare launch assignments will help the spacecraft to avoid a 2-year wait for its launch. Earlier, launch of Lunar Trailblazer was planned to take place as rideshare payloads on NASA's Interstellar Mapping and Acceleration Probe mission, or IMAP, which will be sent in 2025. According to reports, Glaze at first didn't detail about the procedure through which NASA decided to move Lunar Trailblazer from the IMAP launch to IM-2. Later, she stated that the agency's Lunar Discovery and Exploration Program decided to accommodate that additional cost of launching on IM-2 rather than staying on IMAP. Bethany Alman, the Caltech professor, who is the principal investigator for Lunar Trailblazer, said, "Our Lunar Trailblazer project is pleased that NASA has planned a launch for Lunar Trailblazer in 2023 to get Lunar Trailblazer's high-resolution water ice maps to the science and exploration communities to understand the lunar water cycle and inform future landed missions. Alman said the Trailblazer passed its systems integration review in May and is scheduled to be completed by early 2023. Sources state that Lunar Trailblazer is fitted out with a spectrometer and thermal mapper to study the volume and distribution of water on the moon that will be helpful for future manned missions. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting, and kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comment section. This will help us to improve.